COVIMED PR Top Domain, Lighthouse Translation and Interpretation Services, Cape Air, and United Airlines. And we are all deeply grateful for your support. This historic event brings together for the sixth time in HEDS Chronicles a remarkable amount of expert academicians to highlight the most prominent opportunities to enhance Hispanic higher education through the savvy use of technology. This outstanding group of professionals creates an extraordinary synergy from which we hope you take advantage during this event. The HEDS Consortium is overly excited to have been able to attain for this event the presence of 27 out of 42 of its member institutions from Puerto Rico, the United States. We also welcome attendees from other institutions and organizations who are interested on this topic as well. All of HEDS institutions are nationally known for being at the forefront of the integration of new technologies to serve its students and specifically the Hispanic community. This was confirmed through the more than 20 proposals received from all member institutions to participate in this event. It will also be demonstrated through the insightful discussions and the main speaker presentation, which HEDS will be presenting this morning. Now, as part of the welcoming remarks, we would like to introduce a very talented and risk-taking businesswoman that has been leading the HEDS successful operations for the past 13 years. As executive director of this consortium after being appointed by the board of directors on January 2006. Jubelkis has taken the consortium through a 13-year journey of consistent evolution, expanding its membership, creating new services, and proposing new educational technology options for its constituents. Let's give a warm welcome to Jubelkis Montalvo, HEDS executive director.
Thank you, Lynn, and thank you. Good morning, everyone. Buenos dias. We are pleased that you accept our invitation and so proud to be able to organize this event one more year for our members, collaborators, and peer organizations and institutions, despite the earthquake and its consequences that you all know of, especially us. Thank you for all of you for your message, your emails, your calls, prayers, and thoughts during these difficult times. Especially, we truly appreciate the executive committee support who helped us decide to celebrate this event as scheduled. Definitely, this is another exciting best practices showcase for HEDS and its members, especially since this is an opportunity for academic leaders from member institutions to share their best knowledge and expertise. We hope that this will be an enriching opportunity for all of you. We greatly appreciate the ongoing support of our members, the collaboration of our corporate partners, and the consistent trust and guidance of the board of directors, its executive committee, the staff, especially from our host institution, and others collaborators. Events like this are definitely a result of a team effort. As we continue to work together, we will continue to solidify our mission, focus on the transformation of teaching and learning through technology and the success of Hispanic students. Thank you again for joining us, and I hope this event gives you wonderful opportunities to network with other key leaders and take away important tools, resources, and lessons to continue enhancing your practice and providing new opportunities for Hispanic in a higher education. Enjoy, and thank you so much. Have a good day.
Now, to continue with the welcoming remarks, please welcome President Manuel J. Fernos, President of the Inter-American University, who kindly offered these outstanding facilities to hold the conference. Please welcome President Fernos.
Italy. Well, good morning and a warm welcome from our Caribbean winter at the School of Law of Inter-American University of Puerto Rico. We would like to thank you for joining us at another edition of the HETS Best Practices Showcase, where we gather to exchange ideas, experiences, and knowledge. But we also seek to create and develop new collaboration opportunities. I am particularly humbled by the show of support that has made it possible for all of us to be here despite the current situation that has developed in the south and southwest part of the island these two past weeks. Technology is the means to aid in global problem solutions. It is a tool to expand educational outreach, and it is a way to promote the growth of the creative spirit that characterizes a university student. Through the effective use of technology, higher education institutions can provide access and inclusion to the most vulnerable students and minorities. This is why it is imperative that institutions committed with success of its students' community work to create a consistent experience from the moment a student is recruited until he or she graduates and beyond. I would like to invite you to keep an open mind and an inquisitive, curious approach through the event. Talk to your fellow participants, ask questions to your speakers, and make the most out of your experience. Once again, welcome to Puerto Rico, welcome to Inter-American University, welcome to HETS. Good morning.
Thank you, President Fornos. To conclude our welcome remarks, I would like to present the HETS chairman, Dr. Carlos Vargas Aburto, who was elected chair of the board of directors of the HETS consortium during the summer board meeting of June 2015. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Dr. Carlos Vargas Aburto, president, Southeast Missouri State University, and chair of the HETS board of directors.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure for me here to see you all here. Thank you very much for experiencing the Caribbean winter in Puerto Rico. It's wonderful to be able to say that. We are very pleased to be here. I am proud to bring with me three other members of Southeast Missouri State University, and I would like to also say, making reference to the situation in Puerto Rico, that we are here standing in solidarity with our brothers and sisters of this wonderful place, and we're hoping that the tremors will subside. I personally have experienced a 7.5 earthquake in Mexico City. Some of you may remember that in 1985, and that was terrible. I was in the fifth floor of a building, and it lasted probably about a minute and a half or so. So it was scary. But anyway, thank you very much. On behalf of the Executive Committee of HETS, it really is a pleasure for me to welcome you. It is a pleasure for me to see those of you who were able to make the trip to Puerto Rico be here with us. Enjoy the rest of the showcase. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vargas. And finally, I would also like to acknowledge the presence of all of you who have joined us this morning for this special event. A round of applause for yourselves, please. Thank you for being with us. And now we will continue with our special presentation. The HETS Consortium has elevated collaboration to a new rank, bringing together higher education institutions from the United States Puerto Rico, Latin America, and representatives from the government, private, and academic sectors for the past 26 years. Also, HEDS has distinguished itself as a forefront organization in the integration of technology for the advancement of higher education and learning opportunities for the Hispanic community. In our interest to continue this discussion, the HEDS Consortium is proud to open this best practices showcase with the presentation of Dr. Peter Shia. But first, let me share a few tidbits of information about Dr. Shia. He is the Associate Provost for Online Learning at the University at Albany, SUNY, and provides leadership and strategy for online teaching and learning in collaboration with academic, administrative, and support units across the university. Dr. Shia is also a professor in the University Albany School of Education with a joint appointment in the informatics program in the College of Emergency Preparedness, Homeland Security, and Cybersecurity. Very, very pertinent in these days. His research on technology-mediated teaching and learning in higher education has generated more than 8,000 citations. He is the author of more than 50 peer-reviewed journal articles, book chapters, and proceedings on the topic of online learning and co-author of The Successful Distance Learning Student. Dr. Shia is a co-recipient of several national awards, including the EDUCOS Award for Systemic Progress in Teaching and Learning for the State University of New York, and Sloan Consortium Awards for Excellence in Faculty Development and Asynchronous Learning Network Programs, and was named a Sloan C. Fellow in 2011. He is also Editor-in-Chief of Online Learning Consortium's Online Learning Journal. At the end of Dr. Shia's presentation, you will have the opportunity to make questions. But please make sure you use the microphones at the hall on the side of the theater. And now, please help me welcome Dr. Peter Shia with a round of applause.
Thank you. It's great to be here. I've had an opportunity to talk to several of you this morning, and I have to say I'm very impressed with the level of participation in the conference and the level of the participants. In technology, we're often meant to be disruptive. We're meant to shake things up, but I don't think we're supposed to shake things up this way. So I hope that we won't shake things up that way, but we'll continue to disrupt and be disruptive in the way that we've all come to know. I want to thank you for inviting me here today. I've got some things to talk about, some of which are related to online learning, some of which are related to more recent developments in technology and automation. My background, can we bring the presentation up?
Yeah.
They're working on it. My background is in online teaching and learning research. I've done research on online learning for more than 20 years. I'm in the School of Education where we have online programs that date back to the 1990s. I started teaching an online program in 1998 myself. So some of what I have done is sort of an historical record of investigation. And a lot of this research can be found at this website. It's called the How People Learn online website. It's sunyresearch.net, How People Learn. All of the publications that were referenced in the introduction are here. These publications have generated about 8,000 citations in the scholarly literature. There are many different examples of studies of how people learn in online environments. And a lot of what we've discovered can be summed up by this one diagram. The sort of instructional design, facilitation of discourse, and direct instruction, the quality of those allow instructors to create an environment where students feel that they can project themselves as real people, that they can connect with others as real people. And those contribute to variance in how much students learn. Reports of high levels of learning are predicted by instructional design, organization, facilitation to discourse, direct instruction, So teaching presence, social presence, and cognitive presence. So I thought I wanted to get that out of the way. I think that sums up most of what I know about how people learn in online environments, and there's a lot you can pick up by reading some of the other materials on that website I just mentioned. More recently, I've become interested in the effects of automation on human cognition and human learning. And some of the books that have influenced my thinking include this book, The Rise of the Robots, The Glass Cage by Nicholas Carr, who also wrote an excellent book called The Shallows. I don't know if anybody's heard of The Shallows. Great book. And The Second Machine Age by Eric Bjornholt and David McAfee. They also have another new book out called Platforms, Machines, and Learning. I think it's together these getting a hard time. This was working this earlier. Together, they present some interesting and potentially concerning information about the effects of automation. But before we start with that, how many people know who this is? Have you ever seen this man before? That's Arthur Samuels. And this is a picture of Arthur Samuels, the father of modern data and computing. He's writing a program in Checkers to create a Checkers program that can beat him in Checkers. This is, again, in 1956. So he was successful at writing this program that could beat him. And we've gone on and done this again and again. Machines can learn, right? They can learn how to do things. And some of the things that machines have learned how to do include these: reading and writing, speaking and listening, looking at things, and integrating knowledge. There's a good example of this was Watson. How many people remember Watson on Jeopardy? Yeah, Watson, IBM's artificial intelligence computing system, beat the champions of Jeopardy soundly and led to this acknowledgement. I, for one, welcome our new computer overlords from Brad. So what we're seeing is not only developments like that a few years ago with IBM's Watson being able to beat people at natural language processing and answering questions on the fly. IBM's Watson has spawned these other sort of innovations, tech support, health administration, global imaging. It also, I found they're using this image processing to identify new Nazca lines in Peru. Some interesting stuff that's been happening quite recently with the advancement in automation and these newer things that computers can do. Another example of things that computers can do is drive cars, right? So we see Google and Waymo developing these self-driving cars. And it represents some interesting and challenging developments. These cars have driven more than 1 million miles. They've driven across bridges, they've inched through traffic, they've gotten on and off highways. And they've done that without a whole lot of problems. There's been a couple of accidents. One was a relatively serious accident with a death, when the safety driver wasn't paying attention, was looking at their cell phone. And one set of problems is when they encounter human beings. Human beings tend to act irrationally relative to what computers do. People will pull up to an intersection and vie for advantage to get into the intersection. The computers are frozen. They don't know what to do. The self-driving cars become paralyzed. I don't know what you do with these humans. They're problematic. So they've been driving these cars, and someday we're going to have self-driving cars. Someday we're going to have self-driving taxis. Probably it'll start with taxis. Probably start with delivery. This is an interesting quote by William Gibson. The future's arrived, it's just not equally distributed. That future of self-driving cars has been going on already. There's been self-driving taxis for more than a year, and they've driven 100,000 trips to 1,500 monthly subscribers to that service. It's not coming in the future, it's now. So after that accident, we probably think, well, they've got the self-driving cars, they're probably still in a test stage where they're keep a safety driver with the self-driving car until we get that figured out, right? It would be crazy after one accident to have that be going on. But they're not using safety drivers. They're using self-driving cars with no safety drivers. And it's relatively new. This must be short trips, right? It can't be that dangerous or that extensive. But it is. It's been going on. UPS has been delivering packages for more than a year. Nobody knew. They drive packages and deliver packages in Phoenix and in Arizona. They drive a 115-mile route with nobody in the car delivering packages. So, well, it's relatively small, 115 miles. It's relatively local. That's what harm could that do, right? That's not how it's going on. This truck just drove across the United States from California to Pennsylvania with nobody in it and delivered dairy products. So the future is already here. It's just not equally distributed and not everybody knows that it's here. So another example of things that computers can do is they can see, right? They can see faces. Facebook developed software that can recognize faces only 0.25% less accurately than human beings can. That was a few years ago. And you can see some of the 3D modeling that went into their development of that facial recognition technology. So a few years ago, they were 0.25% worse than humans. Now it's better. Now the facial recognition technology is actually better than humans. In around 2016, that happened. So computers can see, they can integrate knowledge, they can drive cars, they can recognize faces. And those technologies have been used in a relatively wide range of applications. The facial recognition technology is being used to prevent retail crime, unlock phones, do smarter advertising, find missing people. So there's a wide range of very helpful applications to these developments. Not all of them are so helpful. So we've got a giant surveillance state being developed in China based on facial recognition technologies, which has some people concerned. This computer vision system is tied to a social credit system that tightly monitors and rewards and penalizes citizens according to their behavior. And it could potentially spill over outside of China. So computers can see, they can drive, computers can also write, right? So what can they write? Things like hello world or blah, blah, blah. Well, they're writing articles every day. The Washington Post has a robot reporting program called Heliograph. In its first year, it produced 650 articles and earned the Post an award for excellence in use of bots from its work on the 2016 election coverage. And readers don't know which stories are written by people and which stories are written by computers. There's other developments. Computers can speak. This is a Microsoft researcher giving a talk in China while his speech is simultaneously being broadcast in English and in Chinese on the fly with his voice as both sources. So his voice in English and his voice in Chinese simultaneously. It's a very rapid area of development, human speech translation. So all these developments have spawned entirely new innovations and new industries. Industries in these different areas in finance, manufacturing, medical, diagnostics. So there's no doubt there's been great advances made and great progress made, but there's also been some concern. Traditionally, labor productivity and other metrics of human progress are kind of go hand in hand. So labor productivity, real GDP per capita, private employment, and median family income all have, historically have gone up in tandem. There's been a high correlation between them. Around 2000, with the introduction of computing and automation, we started to see a separation of that. This is called the Great Decoupling by Eric Bjornjolson and David McAfee, between labor productivity, between productivity and these other indices of human well-being. Some folks think that this is a function of computers taking over jobs from people and leaving less of the pie for humans and more of the pie for companies that produce the automation. So leaving that aside for a minute, this is not happening with online learning, right? My area of interest is online learning. Well, here's what Sebastian Thrun said a few years ago. Udacity is my response to the development of AI. The mission I have to educate everybody really is an attempt to delay what AI will eventually do to us, because I honestly believe humans should have a chance. So Sebastian Thrun, I don't know if you remember, he was a high-level executive in Google who started Udacity, the massive open online course platform. He sees potentially the threats of AI. So I think there's been tremendous progress and tremendous human advancement, but there's also been some concerns about what AI can and may do to humans and to society. There's been some interesting other work. Humans Are Underrated by Jeff Colvin, I think, is an interesting one. And he's talking about, in this book, what humans can do that machines can't do. And I think this gets back to where I want, what I want to talk to when I'm talking about teaching and learning in online settings. And Colvin talks about learning being a complex human ability, learning being cognitive, social, psychological, developmental, affective. And there are certain domains in which humans can outperform machines. And Eric Bjornjolson and David McAfee give us this insight. We should be racing with machines, not against machines. So there are applications of this when we start to think about teaching and learning, and online learning specifically. One example that Bjornjolson and McAfee provide is that humans working with computing systems can beat purpose-built standalone programs that have traditionally beat humans in chess. So humans plus machines beat machines by themselves. So it's sort of an interesting opportunity for educators to think about it. And I think we can think about it in this way. We've got people up on top of Bloom's taxonomy with abilities for creating, evaluating, and analyzing. And artificial intelligence can be thought of as a tool for application and understanding. And other technologies can be used for search and remembering and retrieval. So there's opportunities, I think, to work with machines to achieve these goals. I'm going to skip over this one. So I think the... Not sure what that is. Okay. I think when we think about what possibilities that artificial intelligence computing has, we have to think about ourselves. We have agency and can make choices, and we shouldn't be accepting automation blindly. We should start with our own teaching practices and be reflective about what we're doing and ask ourselves, what are we giving up and what are we gaining through the use of technology? What are we giving up and what are we gaining? One way to think about this is that there are humanistic values for learning. Learning is done in communities, and communities reflect values. Values can be instrumental or generative. Mitch Resnick at MIT talks about this in his book, Learning to Code and Coding to Learn. He says he's more interested in the Scratch community as an affinity space where people gain valuable opportunities to take on new kinds of identities, identities as contributors, identities as people who code and grow through their participation in the community. And Resnick says this, I think there's a real risk that we as a society are going to end up giving too much privilege to the types of knowledge and types of activity that are most easily evaluated computationally. So the issue is what people tend to learn is what we tend to test. And if what we test is what can be tested computationally, we end up losing a lot of the valuable opportunities for teaching and learning. Resnick talks about the Scratch community as advocating a community of practice approach in which students engage in authentic activities of learning skills, more complex strategies, and even values. Skills like dividing complex problems into simpler parts, refining designs, and identifying and fixing bugs. Strategies like solving problems, communicating complex or abstract ideas, and designing projects. Values like sharing and giving credit and collaboration, perseverance. Those are things that machines don't typically do. They're not geared toward that. Another way to view the opportunities for teaching and learning in the age of artificial intelligence is to think about empathy. So millions of years of evolution have kind of hardwired us for empathy. We're empathic, we can't help it. Students value empathy. Online education should, prioritize empathic teaching. Another way to look at this is, I think, through the eyes of George Siemens. Folks know George Siemens at the University of Texas Arlington. He asked these questions. Does it foster creativity and personal expression? And does it develop learners to contribute to formation as a person? I think these are important questions for us to keep in mind as we are increasingly engaged with technology and automation. Okay. I think. I was warned about this. So I think there are places where humans excel. This is from Bjørnson and McAfee's most recent book. Digital technologies do a poor job of satisfying our most social drives. Work that taps into these drives will continue to be done by people. Tasks that require empathy, leadership, teamwork, and coaching are among those that will hold promise for humans going forward. So what do we do knowing this? One thing you can do is to be an online instructor who does these sorts of things. These recommendations are based on something called the Gallup-Purdue Index. We have good evidence that the social, motivational, effective dimensions of teaching and learning really matter to our students. These are called the Big Six because they're powerful enduring effects on students. So being a professor, an online professor that makes students excited about learning, cares about students, encourages students to pursue their goals and dreams, assigns long-term projects and the like, actually has a powerful effect on other outcomes. So when students experience those Big Six characteristics from their faculty, they also have better outcomes, including time to degree. Okay. And subsequent well-being and subsequent professional development and engagement. So those kinds of characteristics, when they're expressed by faculty, have long-term consequences for students. And these are activities that humans are particularly well-suited to. So what should we do with online learning to make it better than the classroom, according to the research literature? I think that's one of the questions that we can continually need to ask ourselves. Technology holds promise to elevate what we've done in the past and to improve upon it. If we think about technology as a tool, we wouldn't hand out hand saws to people and expect them to compete with carpenters who have electric tools. So there are opportunities. There's meta-analytic evidence about what we should be doing. In 2005, Zhao and his colleagues looked at this, and I thought one of the best meta-analysis up to that date. And what they found was publication year for the studies that looked at online learning and classroom instruction was sort of an important factor. And that year, 1998, corresponds with the year that learning management systems came on the scene and two-way interaction between students and teachers and distance learning became much more prevalent. So you can see that one of the things that matters is being involved. Instructor involvement in this meta-analysis was also found to be a significant contributor to making online learning better than classroom learning. So the use of LMS, two-way interaction, and high levels of involvement on part of the instructor result in better outcomes in online learning relative to the classroom. So this human interaction matters to students. Students report higher levels of satisfaction and higher levels of learning when there's higher levels of interaction between students and teachers and students and students. These interaction types are summarized here, about a half a standard deviation with student-to-student interaction and improvement over classroom instruction. So how do we enact these opportunities where human interaction and student-to-student interaction and student-teacher interaction and student-content interaction are at the forefront, are foregrounded? I think one of the interesting resources that can be used is this Teaching Online Pedagogical Repository from the University of Central Florida. Is anybody familiar with UCF's efforts in this area? They have this online repository of practices, best practices that support students in terms of course content, interaction, and assessment. And it's an extensive repository of best practices that can be used for the design and improvement of online coursework based on this research that I was just presenting. So you see using discussion prompts to facilitate discussion, implementing, these are just examples of sort of the best practice recommendations that they have with links to more information about those. So what we know about online learning, there's been 17, about 17 meta-analyses to this date that indicate it can be as good or better. To make it better requires that we align assessment with instruction, promote interaction, build a sense of learning community, support self-regulated learning, replace lectures with more active learning, identify big picture goals and big ideas in the discipline, and inform faculty about learner status and progress and risks. So what is the role of AI in all of this? If we're going to work with machines instead of against machines, what role does AI play? And I think there is a good role for AI. And this is from EDUCAUSE's recent work on artificial intelligence and higher education. And their recommendations and descriptions include institutional support, student support, and instructional support. Institutions are increasingly using artificial intelligence in marketing and recruitment efforts, admissions and enrollment, curricular and resource planning. In student support, they're using it for guidance, just-in-time financial aid when students have insufficient funds and they may be just a little short of money. They can be identified and offered small microloans that allow them to be retained. And for early warning systems, so we know when students are not logging into a course, they can be identified and instructor notified. There's also increasing use of artificial intelligence for self-paced progress, personalized learning, and pedagogical improvement. I've seen some very recent examples of tools where artificial intelligence has been used to facilitate discussion among larger groups of students in online courses. So I think if I was to revise the model that I initially presented, I think there's a place both for humans and artificial intelligence at the highest levels of Bloom's taxonomy, and that increasingly artificial intelligence represents an opportunity for enhancing our ability to facilitate higher levels of learning and critical thinking, creating, evaluating, and analyzing. So at that point, I'll just stop and take questions if folks have any. So thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. We've got a microphone for questions.
I wanted to, in your research, how are students being prepared? I mean, everybody assumes because every student has a smartphone and you know, technology is so so widespread, if you will, that students are ready to take an online course. And we have found that that's not the case, particularly for students who are first generation, low income, think the digital divide is alive and well. So how do you, in your research, have you found, particularly for low income, first generation students and their ability to be successful using course management systems and be able to successfully navigate, if you will, the technology piece of an online course?
I think it's a good question, and I appreciate that. We've done quite a bit of research on the effects of engagement or participation in online learning at the community college level, especially among first-generation students, among students of color. And we've found, I think as you're suggesting, that those students do tend to struggle. Community college students, there's a large literature, a large and emerging literature on the struggles that community college students experience in online environments. Students tend to have lower GPAs, they tend to have slightly lower course grades, and at the course level, students are struggling. What's interesting is there's sort of a paradox, and the Chronicle of Higher Education highlighted some of our work and talked about this as the online paradox, the online education paradox, in which they're doing worse at the course level with lower grades, but better at the program level, getting through their college degrees at higher rates than others they would otherwise in the absence of online learning. So there's sort of a mystery to untangle, and I think it's the opportunity that students have in terms of the number of courses that they can take because they're available online. They can sort of increase their course load and benefit. Shauna Smith-Jaggers, who's on the editorial board of the journal that I am editor of, has done a lot of work in this area, and she's got some very interesting ideas about what kind of additional student supports need to be in place in institutions that are heavily online, and institutions that are dealing with first-generation students. And so I think it sort of supports the question that you're asking, what do we need to do in order to not only help these students get through a program quicker, but to succeed at the course level. I think that's still an unanswered question, because study after study is showing that at the course level, students tend to do slightly worse. Other questions?
Good morning.
Good morning.
There was a slide that you showed about robots writing articles in the Washington Post, right? So my daughter's a writer, and she may have to switch careers somewhere down the road, right? But I was thinking about, and I don't know if anything has been done in this area, because you've indicated that we've had trucks driving across country, and a lot of folks don't know about that, right?
Yeah.
We've had these self-driving vehicles, and a lot of people don't know that it's already happening. Do you foresee where AI or technology will be teaching online courses and removing faculty and humans from that interaction, and is it already taking place and we don't know about it?
I think that's an interesting question, and my entire presentation is meant to be, how do we avoid that happening? You know, what is the pedagogical sort of value system that we need to adopt sort of, you know, worldwide in a sense, to avoid having the things that computers are good at being the things that curriculum is about. So I did my doctoral work in curriculum instruction, and it's an interesting sort of obscure area for many people, but the central question of curriculum is what's worth knowing, right? Mm-hmm. What is worth knowing? And if we start to hand off to artificial intelligence computer systems, what's worth knowing is what they can test, what artificial intelligence and intelligent tutoring systems can test. And they can't test everything. They can't test things that humans are good at. So is it happening? Yeah, I think it is happening. Intelligent tutoring systems are sort of, this ideal that many corporations would like to get into, to be able to replace the highest cost in any educational organization is the cost of instruction. If we could reduce the cost of instruction, we'd be much more efficient. But yeah, it's happening. And I think we need to fight against it, and we need to own the value system that will prevent that from happening. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Other questions?
I have one. So I want to ask about the data analytics and the learning analytics, and how can we ensure, if it's possible to ensure, that this information, this data, doesn't become part of the person, just like we have the worry of health analytics, right, becoming part of the whole scenario of the individual and not being able to get insurance as a result of what we know. Yeah. So I'll leave you with that.
Tremendous privacy issues that are raised by all of these applications of technology. And what can we do about it? Again, we have agency, and we can make decisions, and we don't have to accept this blindly. But I think your point is incredibly important, that all of the applications of artificial intelligence open up Pandora's boxes of consequences if we're not careful about it. A University of Albany alum, yay.
I have a concern, and I'm interested in your views on it. On the one hand, we know theoretically we should be going towards competency-based learning. And yet there are restrictions in terms of how our universities are structured and how regulations are involved here. How should we walk that fine line between where we should be going and where we can be going because of all these regulations? And just get your views on that.
That's a good question. I think competency-based education represents one opportunity for an educational model, but I don't think it's the only opportunity for all educational models. I think it works in certain disciplines and in certain areas and in certain institutional types, but I wouldn't say that we all want to be Western Governors University. I think that there are benefits to the more traditional ways that teaching and learning have been carried out in higher education for generations. I think, again, I would get back to the idea that these tools do represent powerful opportunities for enhancing what human beings can do. One example I think that to me was impressive is the use of artificial intelligence to help with peer-to-peer learning or peer grading systems. As we try to ramp up online learning, we're seeing the need to potentially have larger course sizes and a diminishment of a learner-centered model of teaching and learning with a more content-centered or more assessment-centered. But these new artificial intelligence applications are allowing teachers, professors, faculty to see where students engage in more serious ways and are more able to provide peer feedback and reward those students for their more sophisticated peer feedback and identify students who aren't taking it seriously so that new kinds of grouping for peer-to-peer learning can be enacted. But I think, the opportunity is working with these technologies, and that's just one simple example. There are other examples of new uses of artificial intelligence that I think support discursive models of teaching and learning, models of teaching and learning that are based on human to human interaction, but making that more efficient and effective. I'm not sure if I got exactly at your question, but okay, thanks.
One question that comes up in my mind is, how does the online learning environment is affecting the teaching when there is such an emphasis on increasing productivity of faculty members? And I imagine in some ways technology is opening doors to exploring angles of the learner that maybe in a face-to-face environment you don't quite necessarily see or deal with. And so it almost seems like the number of doors now, the opportunities to explore how the learner works are increasing, and as such, how is that affecting the ability of the faculty to spend the time doing that when at the same time faculty are being asked to be more productive?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that there's the use of technology is opening doors, especially in online environments where the entire record of discourse is always available and can be reviewed at any time, that allows us to see teaching and learning processes that are ultimately lost in face-to-face traditions of teaching and learning, which are largely oral traditions. This recording of all of the aspects of teaching and learning provide data for gaining insights into how students learn and how best to teach them. It provides data to understand who is being advantaged and who may be being disadvantaged in classrooms. So I think that there's all kinds of opportunities for gaining greater insight. So I agree with the implication of the question.
I just feel that the workload issue for faculty probably is also plays an important role. I can imagine sometimes a faculty member seeing the opportunity to go deeper but not being able to do it, considering the number of, I think the online teaching initially perhaps was seen as something easier to do, but I imagine that in reality it's actually quite demanding on the faculty members.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that there has been I think students initially looked at online courses as easier to do and found out that they're not easier to do, that in fact they can be harder to do. They require greater levels of self-regulation, they require more focus, more attention, more proactivity on the parts of students. And I do agree with you that faculty tend to feel that they work harder in online courses, that there's more work involved, and that I think you're right, the opportunity is in using these tools to offload some of that work. But I think we've got to be careful in offloading the work onto the technology. We have to be mindful of what we're asking the technology to do and not asking the technology to sort of take over and be the core answer to what matters in teaching and learning. And suddenly what matters is what this technology can do, not what human beings care about, right?
Yeah, thank you.
Good morning. In this arena,
Can you get closer to the mic?
The research has been, very, very varied and intense in the last, decade, 20 years, if you will. Rigor, styles, student success, those type of topics. A question that always comes to mind when we talk to faculty is that X course, say my course, cannot be taught online.
Mm-hmm.
And again, there are like 50 answers. So what's the truth, if you will, based on your experience and maybe your research in terms of subjects that may not be well suited, if we can label it that way, for online learning?
I've been working in this field as a part of the SUNY Learning Network back when that was SUNY's system level efforts for online teaching and learning, where we worked with 64 different colleges. We spent 100 days a year in face-to-face faculty development activities with thousands of faculty over the years. And that question probably was asked at every single engagement that we did by somebody who was new to online learning. In those days, it was like, well, you know, maybe the math and hard sciences are a little bit more difficult to do because of the limits of text-based representation that we had in learning management systems back then. But I think increasingly, the answer to that is, tell me who's not doing online learning in some area. Mm-hmm. It's being done in basically every discipline on the planet. I get submissions to the journal for obscure disciplinary studies of online learning applied to some discipline I barely knew existed. So I don't think there really is a limit on what we can do with online learning as it relates to the disciplinary content. I think pretty much any subject can be taught online if the course is designed to do it, designed with learning in mind. So I don't see any limits that way.
Thank you.
So Dr. Shea, I'm also a SUNY Albany alum.
Congratulations, thanks
from,
for being
from
here.
From your department.
Good to see we have
great,
a success.
Likewise, excellent. So one of the challenges, my 44th year in higher education, and I worked in SUNY and CUNY and now in the California State University system, and one of the biggest challenges that I have found is providing safe space for junior faculty who are interested in innovation and development of course material online. You know, I served when I was provost at Cal Poly Pomona, we had focus groups with junior faculty who said, you know, I've been kind of told by my senior faculty that we don't do that here, i.e. implying that perhaps during the RTP process, they would be disadvantaged. Mm. At CUNY, I was a part of a presidential task force, CUNY-wide, same type of feedback. So in your research and in your work, is that real? Is that, is that something that in order to move the dial, in order to increase the number of online courses and online programs, you talked earlier about student success. How do we ensure that faculty, particularly pre-tenured faculty, who want to do this space? No one's forcing a faculty member to teach an online course, right? Oh. But to provide them with the kind of support where they will not be impacted negatively in the promotion and reappointment process, tenure promotion and reappointment process.
It's a complex question, a complex topic. I don't think there's any black and white simple answers to this. I know in the context that I was in at the University of Albany, in the School of Education, in the Department of Educational Theory and Practice, there was definitely a culture that said, that's not for you, don't do that. Focus on your research, focus on your teaching, get your publications, and when you're done with that, you can go into online learning. I think, as you're suggesting, that represents an sort of a break on innovation and a break on the expansion of access to higher education. I think the answer is in your provost role to talk about recognition and reward systems and say, you know, this is not an easy lift, it's a heavy lift, but maybe we should revisit our recognition and reward systems. What gets recognized in tenure and promotion? Does innovation get recognized? Does participation in activities that are important to the advancement of the campus count towards tenure and promotion? If those things matter, then let's make them matter in tenure and promotion considerations. So I think it's, you know, there's a certain amount of tension there. We want junior faculty to get tenure. We want junior faculty to be successful. But we also want to expand access to higher education. And the way to do it is to integrate the two systems so that we're rewarding what does matter to the institution. So, other questions? If not, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
before we continue, we finish this section, I asked Peter, so please don't go, because we have a token of appreciation of our host, Inter-American.
Thank you very much.
I know that you like handwriting, and also you have a battery pack in case something happened with the power. You will have a battery pack in order to charge your phone. So thank you so much.
That was a
very interesting discussion, and I really enjoyed yesterday. I found Peter at the lobby of the hotel, and we have like an hour of discussion, and we are really happy to have you here. And thank you so much. He is also the editor of the online learning consortium, and we are talking how we can collaborate in order to enhance what we have, and also share, and also bring in one of their conference to Puerto Rico, because he really enjoyed not only the property where we are staying at, but also the city. And thank you, and we definitely will be working on it. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Have a good day. Okay. Okay, now our NC will continue with the final comments in order to go to the break, and we start the concurrent sessions at 11 sharp, okay? Our NC.
Thank you. With this presentation, we officially open the HEADS 2020 Best Practices Showcase inaugural event. But this year, for the first time, we have a pleasant surprise for all our attendees. Thanks to our sponsors, we will have a raffle. All of you received a raffle ticket at the registration table. Now is the time to meet the lucky ones. Yuvelkis Montalvo, please come to the stage to help us do the raffle. Look for your tickets, please. I don't know where she is.
Looking for the tickets.
We need to take photos for our sponsors to see that. Who was from here? Can you please? Everybody have a ticket?
Nice prices, so you better have a ticket. You have one ticket. Yeah, you're supposed to have only one. Okay. My phone. Okay, then I have the second part of the ticket.
She's got it.
Yeah, I know. Don't worry. Okay. I know. Let me, first of all, in the meantime, let me give you a few information of one of our sponsors, Cape Air, is the airlines who do air flights from Puerto Rico to the Caribbean islands, and also Culebras and Vieques. And they have been our sponsor for the Student Leadership Showcase since we started, because they have a very interesting program for pilots in collaboration with the Inter-American University Bayamón campus. And it's a very nice information. A student from Abby, I want to read a little bit. They call it the Cape Air JetBlue University Gateway. And the University Gateway program provides a unique pathway for undergraduate students looking for leasing transition from student to professional sector. Student from an aviation accreditation Board International Accredited Program are eligible to either the Getaway Program during the sophomore year. The program offers structured education, training, and experience preparing each pilot for their future in aviation. And undergraduate pilots in the program have the opportunity to work as intern at the Cape Air. or JetBlue. And in the student leadership showcase that we held in Puerto Rico, since the program is here at the Inter-American, not only they raffle the air tickets, but they bring a pilot to motivate students to get enrolled because there is a lack of students getting into this career. And the thing is that the pilot only have until 50 years or 55, I don't remember when they mentioned, to be, available to fly, because, you know, this is a very demanding career, and after that they have to retire. So they don't have enough pilots enrolling in this career in order to substitute the ones that have to retire now. So from the ones in Puerto Rico, we invite you to check and motivate students to get enrolled to be a pilot. And with this collaboration with Inter-American, it will be very nice. So we're going to have one raffle today and one for tomorrow. So we're going to start. Okay, there. We're going to start with one of their tickets. It's a round. Let me make sure. You want a round trip ticket between San Juan and San Croix in the Caribbean. Okay, you need to call the phone number that is there in order to redeem, get all the information to use the ticket, and you have until January 2021. To use it, so it don't have to be right away. So let's see, you put the tickets, right? Okay, espérate. Let's see who is the winner. I'm not looking. Okay, we're gonna, I'm gonna say the last four. 6, 7, 7, 9. Hey, muy bien, one of our presenters, right? Come over. Don't worry, tomorrow you have another opportunity, and tomorrow is for round three for San Tomas. Okay, so here we come. We need to take a picture. Also, we have, in the meantime, okay, let's. Another sponsor is United Airlines. Everybody knows them. And they are giving us a certificate for a valor rate in $650. So the person who wins this certificate could enjoy access to more than 45 United Clubs locations, including Copa Clubs and others participating from Star Alliance. So get ready to see who wins this one. Okay. There is the button. Let me. And you are from? Okay. She is Denise Rivera from the Ana Jiménez University. Cool. Karen, échate para acá. Excellent, enjoy. Okay. Okay, now we are ready for the United certificate for the club, United Club membership. Let me see. Okay, the number is 6900. If you are not here, you can win. I mean, cannot win. No one? Okay, 6900123. Okay, another one. All right, let's see. I probably was for Nos that he left. Sorry. Okay. Okay. Number 6729. Hi, Turner. Come over. From California. Well deserved, because they came from all the way down. So great. Tomorrow we will have another certificate, so please, and we're gonna do new tickets, so because tomorrow we have other people joining us. So, okay, so let's take a picture with Turner, and we have one more prize.
Muchas gracias, muchas gracias. Nunca gano nada.
Ay, qué bueno. Acá, más para acá, más para acá. Espérate, más para acá, en aire. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Okay, now you can enjoy Okay, and the last one is from Office Max, that they have been very supportive with us in the Student Leadership Showcase, and they bring us this. It's half a lot of supplies for the office, and let's see who is the winner. Okay, 6901. Hey, we have another winner. Cool. Are you from Puerto Rico? Yeah, you. Okay, perfect, because for the one who go, this in the baggage, not too good. But anyway, still. Okay. But tomorrow we will have a raffle again, so please make sure to be here when we finish the panel of the track winners to see if you can be the lucky ones. And thank you to our sponsors for these prizes. This is a new activity on this conference, and we hope that in the next best practices we can continue this tradition. Your name?
Shirley Olmos, Interamericana Bayamón.
Ah, Shirley Olmos, the Interamerican University Bayamón campus. Great.
He's the faculty.
Excellent. Congratulations. Tú eres faculty, ¿verdad?
No.
Ah, perfecto. Okay, great. Sí, mira, I trust in everybody. I didn't ask for the ticket, but she was... I know. Okay, so now we finish. Our NC will give you some final instructions. And remember that we gonna start at 11, the concurrent sessions. Now we have a time to network, share, and have a coffee break. And then some changes in the program that she will announce. And also make sure that everybody... get into the presenters, especially get before everyone, so we can upload, especially here in the theater, we have to upload the presentations in the second floor, so please make sure to be before. And then if you need Wi-Fi, the Wi-Fi is open, it's inter-web guest, so you can use Wi-Fi. And also the board members that are gonna join us in the board meeting, that is a closed session in other rooms, our lunch will be between 12:15 to 1:15. So you can enjoy the first concurrent session, then we go to lunch, and then we move to the room in order to have our board meeting, okay? So thank you. I want to also thank you, Lynn, for being very kind and be our NC, and thank you so much, and enjoy the rest of the conference.
Congratulations to all the winners. Before we leave quickly, I need to let you know that unfortunately two speakers were not able to join us. Ms. Indra Palae from Houston Community College, scheduled for 11 a.m. at Amphitheater 4, and Dr. Maria Bonilla Crespo from Inter-American University San Germán campus, scheduled for 3 p.m. at Amphitheater 3. Finally, the presentation scheduled for 2 p.m. at this theater will be a live transmission. Before we conclude this session, we would like to give you some important news and instructions. First, if you need simultaneous translation, you can keep the headphones until the end of the day, but please make sure you return them before you leave. All rooms but Amphitheater four have simultaneous translation since all presentations will be in English. All presenters need to be at the room at least 15 minutes prior to their presentation. Our goal is to follow the schedule proposed on the program. If you're interested in receiving continuing education credit for this event, make sure you fill out the appropriate form at the registration area and sign the attendance list. Sorry. Make sure you have your lanyard visible anytime to facilitate access to all presentations and coffee breaks. The lanyard is required to access the lunch area and the concurrent rooms. At the registration area, you will find any additional information or answers to any questions that you may have about the events of this day and tomorrow. Finally, thank you all for accepting HED's invitation to participate in its 2020 Best Practices Showcase. We hope you can benefit tremendously from the resources and the networking opportunities available for you during this conference. We will now have a 30-minute break right on time at the exhibitors area, and at 11, all breakout sessions will begin at their respective rooms. Once again, gracias, thanks, and enjoy the conference.